Would you like to learn in a school without any boundaries, limitations, and ideas? Where being in the campus itself is a great learning environment. So we are always fascinated by some of the phrases which go like architecture without boundaries and ideas without limits, and always dream of in learning in this kind of an environment. So what if I tell you the case study which we are looking at today demonstrates all of it. So the school is also called as the Temple of Learning, which gave rise to some of the great architects like architect Nimish Patel, architect Chitra Vishwanath, and architect Rahul Mehrotra, just to name a few, and many more. The campus also had the likes of architect Buckminster Fuller, architect Louis Kahn, and the great furniture maker George Nakashima, and some of the world renowned architects visiting and imparting their knowledge to the students. So the school which I'm talking about is none other than the Center for Environmental Planning and Technology in Ahmedabad, which we know as the CEPT campus, and which was earlier known as the School of Architecture and Planning. So the School of Architecture and Planning was founded in the year 1962, and the task of designing this great learning environment was bestowed upon the first Indian Pritzker winning architect, architect B.V. Doshi. This was the first of its architecture school in India, and there was no other great reference. So whenever there were talks about architecture schools, there were always examples of Harvard and Bauhaus, but no Indian example, which was also the primary reason which architect B.V. Doshi had at the back of his mind. So the site allocated for the campus used to be a brick kiln where bricks were produced, and there were some huts around. So the campus is widely spread across 12.5 acres, and initially it started only as the architecture block, but later on various other blocks such as the building services, the interior design, the Kanoria Center, and the Hussein Doshi Gufa were added, and now it functions as a multidisciplinary campus. But in today's video, we would be focusing only on the architecture block, as the same vocabulary continues in the entire campus in some or the other way. So now the question lies, what was the genius ideas that led to converting a brick kiln into a temple of learning which ultimately became world famous? So in today's case study, we would be focusing on the design challenges, the planning of the entire campus, the material palette, the structural arrangement, and the climatic response of the building that have led to some of the big and genius move in shaping this great learning environment. So the brief was to design an architecture college which had studios, exhibition spaces, workshops, library, a canteen, and etc., and all of it which comes under an architecture college. And secondly, it was to design a learning environment without any boundaries, any hierarchies, and a complete free and open environment which emphasized more on learning than teaching. So it was nothing but a search for a new model of education. So without further ado, let's get started into decoding various aspects of this campus. So the complete site measures 12.5 acres in total land, with two sides facing the university road and huge lush green trees planted on the periphery which act as a buffer from the vehicular noise. So the buildings are slightly pushed away from the road, and the entire campus has a north-south orientation to get in maximum north light, which is conducive for working in the studios. There are multiple entry points to the campus, but the main entrance lies on the northern side of the campus with a simple blank wall which guides you to move further and step down below the architecture block at the basement level, which is also called as the ground level. So you step down through the steps to enter and see this amazing first glance, which surprises you at the very first moment, with a huge plaza of steps. The individual blocks at various levels are connected by a series of steps which not only become as a point of transition but also become the places of unplanned encounter. The steps in fact become external activity hubs where people sit for discussion or organizing various juries for reading, for various performances, or even simply lazing around. So now coming to the zoning of this campus. So the first block which you enter under is the architecture block, connected by the admin block with the recent addition of the Leelavati Library next to the Hute Singh Visual Arts Center, then the building services block, the interior design block, the Kanoria Arts Center, the workshop block, the Vikram Sarabhai Community Center, and the famously known Hussain Doshi Gufa. So the blocks are added subsequently with the years, so it is a continuously growing campus. So the ground floor is mostly left open for organizing some informal discussions, jury sessions, performances, and some installations where people can gather and work in large number of groups. So there are very few closed sections on the ground floor, and mostly it is left flexible and consists of unplanned spaces where many recreational activities can take place. And the first and the second floor consists of closed sections such as the studio spaces, model making rooms, thesis discussion rooms, planning cells attached with an administration block, and the old library. Apart from the built spaces, the unbuilt or the semi-open spaces bring an interesting dimension to this entire campus. This was broadly the zoning of various spaces, but the more interesting thing lies in how the plan was exactly conceived. The plan of the building is pretty simple, with just two parallel walled bay with two sides open, which allows the cool breeze to flow through the studios, and two sides as closed, which acts as a climatic shield against the harsh west sun, spanned with concrete beams and kota floor, which can be maintained and extended easily. So this type of planning is called as the parallel wall bay planning. As compared to the traditional way of having windows as fenestrations, here the door is pushed inside to create a breakout space and also to cut the harsh sun, and additionally establishing a visual connection through the entire campus. And this usually is termed as a line of defense to protect against the harsh sun. So the fenestration on the north as well as on the south side not only add up as a climatic benefit, but also become a part of the elevation, so that there is no need to work on the elevation separately. So now coming to how the building was designed in section. As compared to the traditional way of taking in light through the windows, here the building is sliced at an angle of 60 degrees to take in glare-free natural light through the skylights. So there is no need to switch on the light as far as there is light outside. So now let's look at the form development of the building in section, of how exactly the section was conceived. So just taking an example of two similar sized boxes and then increasing the height of one of the boxes to incorporate a double height space, and then slicing at an angle of 60 degrees to take in natural glare-free light through the skylights, and then lifting the block entirely above the ground to create a public space under, which houses the multifunctional activities, which also adds up to the open-ended learning of this campus. So the studios are then blessed with natural light, with a natural wind flow flowing through the balconies and escaping through the skylights, so there is a continuous wind flow into the studios. So due to the building section, there is also a visual connectivity in the studios as well as in the entire campus. Due to the section, the building also establishes a harmonious connection with the landscape, and also which gives an illusion of a floating building, because due to the mounts, we can't see the complete building and one floor is hidden behind these mounts. And the campus tends to expand with the addition of new buildings with new ideologies worth having a look at and getting inspired from. So these are some of the initial sketches and physical models done in order to check the massing of this building, of the ideological process. So these are usually all the diary sketches which we tend to draw at the corner of a newspaper or in our diaries, which really become a building at the end. So as we can see from all the conceptual sketches that the section was the most important part of the entire campus right from day one of its conceptualization, and which has really defined the character of this campus. So now obviously these type of planning decisions have given rise to some of the amazing planning features of this campus, out of which the first would be the dual use of a double height space. So the ceiling is used to hang installation and the floors are used for multi-purpose activities such as games or organizing events, workshops, or even some recreational activities. And now coming to the second most important feature, that is the horizontal versus the vertical interaction. So now what do I mean by this horizontal interaction? So horizontal interaction is nothing but the interaction that happens in between the classroom, that is in the corridor spaces, in the staircases, in the double height unplanned spaces. And the vertical interaction is nothing but the sectional interaction of whichever level you may be in, whether you are in the studios or you are in the campus. So the visual connection through the vertical volume is nothing but the vertical interaction. So both these horizontal and vertical interactions are a great way of learning in unplanned ways. And the third most interesting feature, which is almost famous in all of the photos, is the staircase. So in any normal conditions, conventionally, we would just give a staircase to climb from one level to another. But in this case, just by making a wall angular, it has added an interesting frame right from the front and also from the behind. And on top of that, it also creates a backdrop in the night for various performance activities. It's a great way of handling two different materials, that is in this case RCC as well as brick. So the RCC staircase is separated from the wall, which creates a gap through which light passes, which can be seen in this photograph. So this is nothing but an effect of the 1 feet gap that is kept in between the RCC and the brick. So just to give a reference of what a 1 feet gap can do in a different building is the Ronchamp Chapel by Le Corbusier. So he just lifted the roof by 1 feet and you can see the difference what it has created in the space inside. And also when moving through the campus, it just feels like framing the spaces that create these amazing vistas. So these in-between spaces that are created act as public spaces for various multi-use activities. So the steps that are taken in planning various aspects of this campus are nothing but converting all odd situations into favorable ones, which architect B.V. Doshi always believes in.
So we talk about architecture. I think architecture is a matter of transformation. Transformation of all odd situations into a favorable condition. All these mounds were made by me standing on the rooftop there.
Now coming to the structural arrangement of this building, the structure is kept pretty simple with RCC beams and slabs spanning the structure horizontally and eventually transferring the load to the load-bearing thick brick walls which span the structure vertically and eventually transferring the load to the foundation. And one more important aspect which can be seen in all of the ceilings of the spaces in the entire campus is, instead of taking less number of beams with greater depths, the beams are broken down into series of small beams with less depth, which brings about the harmony in the structural aesthetics. So So the structure does not only merely form in taking the load of the entire building, but also add up to the modern brutalness of the elevation all throughout the buildings in their campus. All the buildings are dressed in just four simple materials, which are starkly visible in the elevation from the outside. The edge beam depth is kept more so that it adds as a separation between the RCC and the brick, and also it helps in spanning the structure, thereby adding to the strong horizontality of the buildings in the entire campus. And with the addition of buildings in the campus, there are a lot of new materials coming up, which is also worth studying. And now coming to one of the most important aspects, that is the climatic response of the building. So it becomes interesting to see how a specific building responds to the climate in which it is located in. And especially in this case, the building being in the hot and dry climate of Ahmedabad, it is interesting to see how it responds to the climate. So there are four major components when it comes to the climate of this campus. Out of which the first would be the parallel wall bay planning. So instead of closing all the four sides of the building, the only two sides are closed and two sides are left open, which enables the cool breeze to flow through the studio spaces. And the second one would be the addition of blank walls, which is a shield against the climate for the harsh west sun. And thirdly, the line of defense, in which the fenestrations are pushed inside slightly to create a deep recess which cut the harsh sun coming in. And lastly, introducing porosity in a solid built form through double heights, skylights, deep recesses, which allows the wind to flow through the space easily and keeps the space inside cool. So now coming to the last and most important segment of this case study, that is the lessons that we need to learn from this iconic case study. So now the first genius move lies in the way the idea of peer-to-peer learning environment was propagated through this building, which is a very important move in case of a creative fields like architecture and design. So there are pockets of spaces created intentionally apart from the closed spaces where unplanned encounters take place and where there is an exchange of ideas. So this is a very important move, because in architecture, more than teachers, you learn from your senior peers by hanging out more with them and helping them with their work. And the campus successfully binds people together through spatial sequences across all the streams. So there is a harmonious interaction between the students of all the years. So now the question lies, how is it even possible? And the clear-cut answer to this is the volumetric planning of the section instead of the continuous floor approach. So the use of levels and double height spaces instead of the conventional floor after floor and classroom after classroom approach builds a vertical interaction among all the years. So the visual participation of the people here is very important. So before going to the next move, did you take a step back to imagine as to where exactly this section might have been inspired from? So have you seen a section of a factory building and the way the north light is taken to it? So this might have been surely the inspiration for this section too. So using the idea of an industrial typology inside an educational campus in itself is a genius move. So at the end of the day, you might get inspired from anything, but it's just the matter of how you use that idea to suit your building requirements. And the next move lies in simply pushing the floor plates to include double height spaces, which creates a visual connectivity as well as the free air movement through the studios. And coming to the next move, that is the student in center approach. Most of the times we tend to design as per the design brief and the areas mentioned in the brief without focusing more on the end user that is going to ultimately use the space. But in this case, understanding of where exactly the student learns the most, that is in the unplanned encounters, in the corridors, in the staircases, and in multipurpose spaces. And the building spaces really get etched in our memory to the extent that we take back with us, and that is the beauty of architecture. So the building leaves us with memories which come handy once we sit on our drawing board to design. And now coming to the end from where it all started, that is the brief which was to design a learning environment without any boundaries, which was achieved by moving away from the traditional classroom after classroom approach towards open-ended learning. And this campus injected this ideology to an extent which really set an example for all the upcoming architecture schools in the country. And lastly, the building leaves us with the overarching experiences of the two masters, Le Corbusier and Louis Kahn, by bringing in light and creating some dark spaces to create an interesting drama from Kahn, and using the below spaces for multifunctional activities and the brutal show of material aesthetics from Corbusier. And lastly, it stands true by the quote by architect B.B. Doshi himself:
"We don't need a road because in Philadelphia, in St. Louis, I wrote that architecture is to open doors, not one but many."
So that's all from my side for today, guys. If you think you learned something valuable from this case study, please do not forget to hit the like and subscribe button below. And please let me know in the comments what are the top 3 takeaways from this case study which you would like to incorporate it into your design or your thesis. And lastly, if you happen to visit Ahmedabad in any case, please do visit this campus so that you can relate to whatever was discussed in this case study.